So welcome to all those who are listening to us today. Today we have a very special session on the topic of caste and economics. No topic is as relevant today as economics is because of the problems that are going that are there, and you know, the communities are facing a lot of issues, the laborers, the migrant laborers, and economies collapsing. And as we know that Baba Saheb Ambedkar himself was an economist par excellence, and he in fact tried to look at the economics from the point of view of a common man, putting the common man at the center of his economics. Walking on his footsteps, our brother today, our friend today, Dr. Jerome Samraj, is going to take us through this journey of and the linkages between the caste and economy. Jerome has been a practicing economist for a long time. He finished his PhD in 2010 from the Madras Institute of Development Studies. And before that, from the Madras School of Economics, he finished his MSc in economics. So he has a long journey as an economist, looking at the problems, the society, the issues of the society. He worked on a very important area of Dalit lands in Tamil Nadu, and he has been writing a lot on these issues. He has been trying to communicate economics to the community through anecdotes, through stories, and at the same time, you know, he's writing academic papers of very utmost importance. So, Jerome Bhai, welcome today for this Ambedkar Karwan Media. Welcome, and Jai Bhim.
Jai Bhim, it's a pleasure for me to be invited to give a lecture in this forum, Ambedkar Karwan, and thanks for that generous introduction, Mangesh. And I have been watching this Mangesh, you have been coordinating this Ambedkar Karwan lectures very well during this lockdown, and it is a pleasure for me to be part of this, and it's an honor. So yeah, so I think we can start it, or straight away go in lecture. Can go.
Yeah, later. I would request Jerome to begin your presentation, because I think the audience are waiting for this. There is a lot of enthusiasm. They would like to know economics is a difficult topic. It's not everybody's cup of tea. But the way you present it, you know, it's immediately. People can grasp it. So I would request you to begin your presentation.
Yeah, thank you. Basically, well, no, we're watching this online, and I'm going to talk.
Jerome, just hold it. This thing.
It's okay now, right?
It's okay, but you know, sometimes, you know, it gets mixed up.
Okay, I'll hold it. I hope this is not very, the audio is very clear now, at least.
Yes.
Okay then. So, basically, I've been learning economics since my UG days, and what I have been fond of is that the economy that is taught in the classroom doesn't reflect or doesn't help us understand what the society is. And the way the society and the socioeconomic activities, the dynamics that happen in the society, it is nowhere related to what we are taught in the curriculum in terms of micro and macro or whatever other subsets of disciplines of economics that we have been taught in classroom. And even the development economics that we are taught is a very clearly a Western import, and has nothing to do much with the way our society functions and our society, our everyday lives are carried on. So with this, I have been reading outside economics, and the way I have been reading about caste, and then this has made me to realize that the kind of social science that we study in classroom is not much relevant to what is happening in the society. And that's why we are not able to create generations of students, citizens, who understand the everyday dynamics of the society and who are responsible for their actions in the society. So with this, what I tried was, even when I teach in classroom, I try to talk economics in a very different sense, where every student, whether he or she is a third generation graduate or he or she is a first generation graduate, they can relate to their everyday lives and then relate to their own presence in the classroom and then understand what economics is all about. So with this short outline, let me straight away go into the presentation.
Yeah.
So this is something that I have been working on for quite some time. So I am sharing the screen. So so basically the Indian society, right? Indian society is a caste-based society. Caste as a single factor, it determines your socio-economic, political, religious rights, and all the socio-economic and cultural rights and political rights are associated to the ritual status, and this ritual status is determined by the notions of purity and pollution. That governs the temple and the ritual procedures of the temple. So, and membership to caste is determined by birth. So basically, if you are born as a Brahmin, you die as a Brahmin. If you are born as a Dalit, you die as a Dalit. So, and there is no question of mobility in this structure. The basic structure of the caste doesn't have any mobility. And it is this kind of a very crude structure that we have been living. The problem with the idea of economics is that economics in the Western society, they are living in a homogeneous society where
there is mobility. Someone
who is a
laborer today can someday become a tenant or someday graduate as a landlord and so on. But whereas here, what we have is caste. So someone who is a zamindar, he can be a zamindar only by his birth, because of his birth.
And who can become a zamindar is determined by the ritual status. Someone who belongs to high and pure caste can be a zamindar.
Jerome, yeah. little bit hold the mic little bit away, huh?
Okay, right.
Now this mic.
Thank you. So someone, you have to be born as a ritually high and pure caste to be a zamindar, and once you are born, you die as a zamindar, right? And similarly, for anyone else for that case, be it a barber or a washerman or whatever it may be, once you are born into a caste, you end up with that. So you have no sense of mobility, no possibility of mobility in this, right? So the caste structure, basically people resort to Varna system, Varna, right? But I don't go into that Varna. I see it is much more communicative if I go to straight away into the village caste structure. So what you see in a village caste structure is that imagine a village where the modernity has not yet reached. So it would have had Brahmins as landlords, Brahmins as land controlling, have upper caste. Then in villages where there were no Brahmins, there would have been Kshatriyas or Vaishyas who were non-Brahmin upper caste, who are controlling lands. And then comes the lower Shudra caste, then comes the service caste, the washermen and barbers, then comes untouchable, and then the service caste to untouchables, right? So if you see, there are artisans. The artisans are also graded in terms of the notion of purity and pollution. We have artisans who work with precious metals, basically the Vishwakarma, who make idols of God or make ornaments with bowls of gold or silver. Then comes the stone sculptors, then comes carpenter, right? Then comes blacksmith, and the last among the artisans will be potters, who will be making clay vessels, utensils for a household, right? Then when it comes to weaver, once again, there are silk weavers and there are cotton weavers. So once again, there's a hierarchy. Silk weavers are superior to the cotton weavers. So, so if you see a village, basically an agrarian village, no, agriculture is the only productive occupation, and the village consists of of all these communities, the Brahmin, non-Brahmin communities, the lower Shudra caste, the service caste, the Dalits, and all of us are involved in a specific agrarian role in the production process, right? So, so village ideally, village is a is not just a geographical space where we are living. It is a production organization where people belonging to all the communities are involved, are organized in a hierarchical order, and they have to deliver the duties of whatever duties they are assigned by the caste system. And the remuneration is also that's a simple hierarchy remuneration. Now, so the village is a space, and what we have to have associated when it comes to village is that the notion of security pollution and the way the residential areas are segmented. So, the village is not a egalitarian space, not everyone can go to every part of the village. So, there are rules of adaptability. And so, people's spatial mobility, spatial mobility in the village is governed by the notion of security and pollution. And so village has never been an egalitarian space, never been an inclusive space. So, though all of us are part of the village system, our roles, our rights, the responsibilities vary depending upon the caste to which we belong to. Right? And one other very crucial factor is that since it is associated to birth, it attaches to permanence. So, there is no mobility here. There is no mobility. So, once if you imagine a village from the perspective of a dominant caste, high and pure caste, the village is very different. But if you imagine the same village from the perspective of a service caste, a barber or a washerman or a lower Shudra caste, it's very different. And the moment you imagine the same village from the perspective of an untouchable, it is very different. So for us, it is a source of, for the Dalits, it's a source of subordination, the source of oppression. So that is the village. So now with this, if you go in further, right? If we superimpose the artisans and weavers in the village structure, we get a village structure like this, where the high and pure caste, the Brahmins from the high and pure caste, then comes a layer of caste, high caste, maybe the Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, Vishwakarma, Shudras, upper Shudras in Tamil Nadu, right? Then comes the lower Shudras, maybe silk weavers or stone sculptors next to them in the as a category. Then comes cotton weavers or carpenters in the next layer. Then comes potters and the blacksmith at the bottom of that, of the touchable. Then the below them comes the washerman and barber, the service caste. So, and the untouchable caste are lined up below that. Right? So with this, so what is most important factor of caste is that the idea of remuneration. This idea of remuneration is determined by the notion of purity and pollution. So what happens to your agrarian role is that a manual labor, which is the most integral part of agriculture. Without manual labor, no cultivation can happen. But this notion of ritual purity and pollution makes manual labor as inferior, right? And hence it is low pay, right? And this inferiority is inscribed through the everyday life of a person in a village. So they'll be treated inferior in every other respect, in terms of religion, in terms of their mobility, the way they should talk to other people in the village, and so on. So the inferiority is imposed over and over and again in everyday life. So, and similarly, the most useless and unproductive work in an agrarian society, that is priesthood, right? That is superior and even sacred. So their position is superior, and their position is retained superior by the system of remuneration, because they own the agrarian surplus. So when all other people are
are involved in agrarian, all other people who are involved in agrarian production process are remunerated just for the labor. Right? The agrarian surplus is retained by the upper caste. Right? So this is how the agrarian surplus is produced. And this, then if you go into, if you see the, whether a multiple caste, yeah, Mangesh?
Jerome, can you hold it tightly, because you know normal times your voice is clear, but sometimes it breaks for 1 minute or two.
I'll go 1 or 2 minutes. Okay.
Sorry.
I'll hold it tight. Yeah, no problem. I'll hold it.
So what happens? You know, it's a complete flow. You're going very beautifully, and okay. then this aberrations comes, and you know, little bit of problem. Sorry.
Okay. I'll try to hold it tight. Okay.
Okay.
So when the
high-end poor caste retain the agrarian surplus, all other class are remunerated just for their labor. And this, when the lower caste are more in numbers, this hierarchy is much more detailed. And we can let us see in the next slide how it is detailed. So when you see the remuneration, so the agrarian surplus is with the high-end pure caste, then the lower Shudra caste who are remunerated in kind. So if it is paddy or wheat or whatever is cultivated, they will be paid in kind. Then comes the service caste. These service caste are given an annual grant. So every year, the entire village community will give them a grant. Then apart from, and that grant will not be very high. That grant will be very meager, so that it's a kind of tokenism, but their prime survival is based upon the food that they collect every day. So this is earlier it is grains, food grains. Now when it comes to service caste, it is food actually. So when you go further down, right? So the service caste have to collect the food from all the houses of the village, whereas when it comes to the untouchable caste, if they work for a specific landlord, they will be given food by them, right? Or else if they work in general, they are not fixed to any specific landlord, so they have to collect food like the service caste from other dominant caste of the household of the village. So now imagine when untouchability is in practice, and though no untouchability is in practice, you are where you can go, where you can walk, to whom, how should you talk to the other person in the village. Everything is determined by that hierarchy. And in this situation, if you are forced to go and collect food from every person or every household in a village, what kind of a humiliation is that, right? And this leaves you no minimal self-respect, right? So you, the any individual belonging to the oppressed caste, have to feel so lowly that they feel so inferior, but then they cannot evade being inferior, because their livelihood, their food depends on someone else, right? So this is the humiliation that we have, right, set up or established in the form of caste structure, right? Now so
what is untouchability here? How is untouchability behind here is that the untouchable caste will be paid in terms of grains, right? Whereas the service caste and the untouchable caste will be paid in terms of food. So when it comes to grain, there is a possibility that the household can save some part of their grains. So even if they do not go for work for 1 or 2 days, they can survive. The grains they have, they can survive. But whereas when it comes to food, you know that no other caste will give the workers the fresh food. They won't give fresh food. What they will give is that they will give fresh food for you as wages. Right? And given the kind of understandability, you can also imagine how they would have given that food also. Right? So with this, what is the idea of giving fresh food is that
for work tomorrow morning,
when it dawns, when the day breaks out, when there is sunlight, you have to go and stand in front of a dominant caste house for work, right? So that is the
politics of hunger, right?
So if you don't understand the caste system and its remuneration, there's nothing other
rather than politics of hunger. Right? So now, so the most cruel part of caste system is this politics of hunger, where now your children's next meal, everything is determined by someone else, and you have to expect them to be merciful on you, right? Despite treating you as untouchable, right? You know that, you know, you won't feel the way they look at you, the way they treat you, you won't feel happy to go before them, but then you have no other choice than to go before them and collect food. So this is the most cruel part, the politics of hunger, that has been ingrained, systematically ingrained for centuries together in the form of village, in the form of caste structure, in the form of untouchability. Right? Now, so, now, so it is based on this traditional hierarchy, the colonial modernity was established. So the traditional hierarchy, right? The traditional hierarchy is that, it has all the civil rights, all the individual rights, property rights, right? The socioeconomic rights, cultural rights, everything is ingrained to your birth. Everything is associated to your birth. Now, you on top of it, you know, we have established the colonial modern state, right? And access to this modern state was determined by the local social hierarchy. Imagine a village where imagine a traditional village about 100 years back or 40 years back, or even now, some village in remote rural areas where there is practice of untouchability today. Now, if there is a government building, or if there is a school, or if there is a panchayat office, or if there is a ration shop, right? That will, or a bus stand, or a bus stop, right? That will be located right in the middle of the main village, the area, residential area of the dominant caste, the high caste. And when there is practice of untouchability, none from the lower caste, none from the oppressed communities can access these, right? So what happens? Caste as a system has easily creeped into the modern administrative setup, and they determine who can access the state and how can they access, and what is the kind of ease in which they access the system. So now you can see, right? If you see this, the way caste has reconfigured through the modern state, through the modern institutions, the politics of access, unequal access, right? This has reconfigured caste in terms of inequalities. Caste in terms of socioeconomic, cultural, educational, inequalities, and inequalities in terms of employment and also housing. So now, you have a structure like this, and the left column is the traditional position, then comes the modern state, right? Then the socioeconomic conditions now, right? So if you see this, you can see that easily, given the all the higher positions, be it judiciary, or be it academia, or be it administration, or whatever it may be, the upper caste are overpopulated in the apex of positions. Right? Then comes the intermediate caste in the intermediate positions. In terms of number, there may be exceptions. There may be one or two, our own great Kerala island. Right? There may be one or two exceptions from the minority. There may be one or two exceptions from the service caste. But then what we have to understand is that we cannot devise public policy based on exceptions. So what we see here is that the caste system has, or the upper caste have been able to reproduce their hegemony, right? Very much intact in the modern system, right? And in the modern system, all the decision-making positions are with them, right? Irrespective of the field, maybe revenue department or education department or whatever it may be, they will be at the top of the decision-making. And there are others, we take the decisions. Whatever they take, the decisions they make, we implement it. And we are in the execution. So sometimes much less than that. Not even in the execution, but we receive, we are at the receiving end. So now, if you see this, what you have, how caste has reconfigured is that right? In terms of educational achievement, in terms of employment, and in terms of power, the right caste has reconfigured itself, right? Now, in order to understand this, we can see, we can just know, there may be people who will say that nowadays there is no caste, there are scheduled castes who are who are in higher positions, much better than upper caste of in my village, and so on. But what we have to see is that, who are our barbers? Who are our washermen? Who are our sanitation workers, right? And now how many of the upper caste, no, the last year the government implemented this economically weaker section reservation, right? Anyone can be economically poor, right? But they will never face untouchability. They will never face discrimination. A Brahmin, however poor, however impoverished he may be, he will never be treated like a manual scavenger. He will never be treated like a barber, or he will never be treated like a washerman, right? So the point here is that this idea of economic equality is our economic condition as an indicator. Right, it's something very much against the idea of social justice. Someone who is poor today, a Brahmin who is poor today, may end up in New Jersey or Columbia or California next year, right? So they have such kind of a social capital which none of the other castes have. So the point here is, how has the dominant caste, the hegemonic upper caste,
their dominance and hegemony within the modern state system and modern education system and modern judiciary and also the market, right? So, for example, I'll tell you,
earlier
we talked about weavers, right? Weaving, they were doing handloom weaving. Imagine modernity, imagine the textiles, power loom coming in during the colonial period, and
the textiles have expanded in the
post-colonial period, right? And if you see, who are the owners in this modern industry? These are the people who own land.
People who own land, they had access to capital. They could go for a loan from a bank, and they could get
money, and they invest, and they could become textile industrialists. Right? Now,
the weavers who were traditionally
weavers by birth,
they are now
wage laborers in that. Imagine the plight of farmers.
The earlier era,
they only had firewood for cooking. Now what we have here is that we have now gas stuff, the metals are coming, the stainless steel metals and all these stuff coming.
And it has, yeah, Mangesh, anything?
Brother, can you try without this mic? Can you directly speak in the computer, possible?
Yeah, I'll do it. Yeah, I'll do it.
Because it's such a beautiful information, and it sometimes becomes a little bit aberration. So just try to pull it and see.
I'll do it now. Yeah.
You talk directly into the computer. I think it can work.
Yeah. Now is it audible?
It's perfect.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. I should have done that before. Okay.
No problem.
Yeah. Okay. Now, so if you see the potters, the plight of potters, right? Earlier, the potters gave vessels for the entire village, right? So then, entire village was their market share. Now, when the modernity comes in, we switched over to metal vessels. And when the metal vessels come in, and we gradually switched over to gas stoves also. So what happens to the potters and their lives? Now they are giving some artifacts, like decorative materials that they are selling now. So their market share has reduced a lot, but then they are right. They remain in that position, in that occupation, right? So similarly, we can see. The barbers and washermen. And similarly, in economics, these people say that once there is regular income, this regular income will help to elevate yourself and it will gradually lead to prosperity. But they have to go to a hill station or an urban area, urban slum, where people are unable to move away from the slums generations after generations, even though they have put in hard
know, hard work throughout their lifetime, right? Now, what is this actually? Why is that the people are very hardworking, but then why are they unable to move out of the slums? Why are they unable to move out of their occupations? What makes them stagnated to their traditional occupation now, right? What makes them as barbers? What makes them continuous washermen? Or what makes them continuous potters? Or what makes them continuous manual scavengers or casual laborers or construction workers and so on, right? So now the idea is, what we have to realize is this modernity and the entire world of modern employment remains inaccessible to all these sections which I've been mentioning now, right? So these continue to be inaccessible, because this access is determined by the social structure. Say, for example, suppose if there is a class, I am teaching in a new university and I have students across different social groups and different social locations. And there are students who are third generation graduates, students who are second generation graduates, and students who are first generation graduates. And you have a system where when 70% of the population are the students studying in vernacular medium, the entire higher education is designed in favor of the students from English medium, right? So my basic question is that when 70% of the people are within the vernacular medium, what is the politics of creating the entire higher education in English? What is the intention? Is it to facilitate education or is it to deprive education? Right? So with this, you have to associate the students' socioeconomic background, the parental background, parental educational background, right? And then associate to their ability to perform in the classroom, right? So given this, right, even if someone goes to a village, school, and that school may be educating all the children from the village, irrespective of the caste. But then what we see here is that, will the teacher in the classroom treat all the children alike? Can a teacher treat all the children, irrespective of the class, irrespective of the background, alike? So this attitude of the teacher towards the students, towards the children, determines the ease at which they go to the classroom, the ease at which they can interact in the classroom, whether they sit right in front of the teacher or whether they sit in the back, whether they hide whether they hide their faces in the classroom, right? Whether they do not like to show up in front of the teacher, whether the teacher likes the student or not. So all these things determine their performance, right? So what you see here is that, even without looking at the answer scripts, we can say that which students are likely to be toppers, which students are likely to be intermediate, and which students are likely to be the bottom, right? So this, right? So what we see here is that we are reproducing inequality, and the socioeconomic inequality reproduces itself as further inequalities. So generation after generation, this will continue to reproduce itself, right? Now, right? Now, let us further go into this. How has caste crept into this modern institution, right? Say, for example, let us take education itself. All of us are produced by a system like this, right? Now, where the examination is memory based, right? And who had the practice of memorizing in this society? The only community which had practice of memorizing are the Brahmins, and no other caste had the practice of memorizing. Now, they have made that as a system. So the entire system is made to benefit some and to kind of create children of specific social group as a cream of the system. And whereas when it came to other, they were very generous, right? When it came to reservation, they were very generous. They told, you find it very difficult to cope up with this examination. Fine, I'll accommodate you even if you score 5 or 10% lesser than me, right? So instead of changing the system, instead of changing the examination system from a memory-based examination to something else, where the examination pattern is very much inclusive, what they tried is that they retained the system, but then they gave a leverage. They gave a small margin. Where they say that all of us can feel accommodated in that, right? So once again, the system is retained, and whereas people like us from the bottom, or who are holding second class degree or a just pass degree, you know, should be grateful for the system that despite their low marks, the system has accommodated them, right? So now this helps the upper caste for different politics, and all of us may be aware, right, what kind of politics that happened around 2006 and 2008 when the OBC reservation was implemented, right? The all that debate, the merit and merit against reservation and so on, right? So now this very age relaxation, this very marks relaxation, 5% marks relaxation that they give are useful for their politics now. Their politics is all about inferiorizing us. Their politics is all about excluding us within the system. You should be part of the system, but you should never be happy about being in the system, right? So that is how the upper caste have reproduced caste within the system. I will give you another example. If you go to any apex institution, any higher education institution, all the messes, they initially they were only vegetarian mess. They did not provide non-vegetarian. They did not give even touchable meat like chicken and mutton, right? And no question of beef and pork, right? Now, even today, there is no policy, but then all the institutions provide only touchable food, and all the institutions are practicing untouchability, right? And what right does these institutions have to determine what the students who hail from very different socioeconomic and political background or socio-religious background to eat? How can they determine that? How can they pre-conclude that they should be feeling happy about eating only vegetarian and chicken and mutton or sometimes fish, right? So this is how now, right? So the system, the institution compels itself to provide the food for the dominant. Whatever the upper caste are comfortable with, the institution will provide. Whereas it is a lenience to include the food of the other, to include the food. So if they provide you mutton or chicken in a conference, in a seminar, or one meal in a conference, you should be very happy and proud about it, right? So that is what the system that we have created, how the system and its space is casteist, right? Now, when we can move to this idea called this informal sector, no? When it comes to modernity, we now know that 93% of the Indian society is informal, right? And why should it continue to remain informal even after 7 decades of policy making, right? Planned policy making, 5-year plans and all that. How is that a vast section of the vast majority, 93%, continues to remain as informal? What is the politics of it? So when you now see, then comes the idea of the modern manifestation of politics of hunger. This modern manifestation of politics of hunger is, if you look into the Minimum Wages Act now, it has been revised to pay 375 rupees. And this 375 rupees, the committee has arrived at this 375 by taking into consideration that each wage earner will be supporting three members, right? And for three members, to support three members, they are suggesting that the minimum wage is 375 rupees, right? You can imagine what is the cost of tea, what is the cost of a coffee, what is the cost of a biscuit, right? A packet of biscuit. Now, when you see a laborer, right? When you see a poor, informal sector construction worker, when you see early in the morning with a pack of Parle G 3 rupee biscuit packet, or a Britannia Tiger 3 rupee biscuit packet with a tea, right? We have to understand that they are skipping their breakfast, right? And the problem here is, these policymakers who are suggesting that 375 rupees is sufficient to support a family of three, right? You can see the arrogance in that. This is nothing less than an arrogance, and nothing less than the earlier politics of hunger, where people were made to work just for yesterday's food, the leftover food, right? Now the recent argument is that they say that a normal person needs 2,700 calories. And given the modernization the kind of sedentary work now, the right, not many people are involved in very heavy work throughout the day, and so the committee is recommending 2400 calories now. Now who determines what should the other eat? Who are these people, right? So how can they say that, right? How can they say that 375 rupees is enough for a family of three, right? So this is something that we have to understand, no? The very cruel face of Indian casteist economist. Now, if you, you know, if you want to know, I would be happy if I have a chance to take them to some other town, some other city, right? Leave them there without their purse, without their credit cards, or without their mobile phone, and give them just 400 and ask the entire family to survive in that place without accommodation, and all that accommodation and transport and everything, food, everything, they have to manage with that 400 rupees, right? So imagine how will they react to this, right? So this is something that we have to understand. How has the Indian education system instilled this insensitivity as part of academic curriculum, right? So this we are producing, right? Though there are students who are laborers themselves, or son or daughter of laborers themselves, they can never see the injustice in the system, right? Right? Say for example, in the classical economics, there is something called as wage fund theory, where these guys write that the laborer should be retained at the level of hand to mouth, right? Who the hell are you to say that the laborer should be retained hand to mouth? What does it mean, right? What does it mean? When someone is intending to say that you have to be maintained at the level of hand to mouth survival, right? How can he or she be father of economics? How can that be classical economics? This is the economics of the landlord. This is the economics of the aristocrats. This is definitely not the economics of the laboring masses, right? So now it is this that has been taught in the classrooms, right? So now, and because they know, we create people who co-opt. Only those people who co-opt perfectly become toppers in the system. So they can score high marks only by becoming by co-opting the knowledge that is pushed upon them. So now, by doing so, even if you are a member of a dominant oppressed community, right, you feel very inferior to be in the classroom. And the curriculum that you are taught, the kind of economics that they're teaching in the classroom, once again inferiorizes you. It says that you are no more eligible than to earn a survival of hand to mouth. And this is the economics that we are teaching the students in the classroom, right? Now, how do they prolong this hegemony? How do they prolong this hegemony is that, see, what it requires for an individual to survive in an urban area, or even in a rural area, right? Imagine that in 2005, Tendulkar committee said 26 rupees is sufficient for survive a day in a rural area, and 33 rupees is sufficient to survive a day in an urban area. Now, imagine that, recollect that. Now, if you are paid so low, right? You are earning 250 rupees or 350 rupees or 400 rupees wage in a day, right? Can we ever have foresight? Can we ever have a foresight about what our children can do, or how to educate our children, which school our children can go, or how long can they be educated, all these things. So if you see all that, what they have done is that they have created a system of insecurity where the large section of laboring population can never be secure in their everyday life. Their every meal is insecure. Every day the children's schooling is insecure, right? So this is the system that we have created. And when this is the insecurity, no one can have foresight, right? Say, when I cannot plan a single day ahead of, right? If I cannot plan my day after tomorrow today, or if I cannot plan tomorrow's today, right? Then how can I plan about a month? How can I plan about a year or so? So the idea of foresight is completely impossible. And so what has happened is that even within the formal sector, right, this idea of keeping the people below insecure is the order of the day. Say for example, so if at all you have to understand what is caste, caste is basically keeping the people below insecure, maintaining them as insecure. now make them feel that their survival is at your mercy, right? So this is caste. And you can see the same in the classrooms, you can see the same in offices, you can see the same in judiciary, you can see the same in state administration, you can see the same in education administration, right? Your promotion may be delayed. The promotion which is automatic, which should come, or increment which should come automatically, will be delayed. Right? You should be always expecting the mercy of the boss, the superior, respect, pleasing him in every act. Right? So this is a kind of insecurity, right? They have created within the systems, and this in no and right now. And one other point that I have to talk about is that how does this idea of notion of purity and pollution continues to determine the wages? Say, for example, the construction worker may be paid about 500 rupees or 600 rupees or 1000 rupees, depending upon which urban locality they are in. A woman casual worker may be getting 250 rupees or 400 rupees within that range, right? Despite an intensive physical labor. Now, say for example, a construction worker is involved in constructing a wall. That's a tangible output. And this tangible output will exist for another 30, 40 years. And after creating this, he is being paid 500 rupees or 600 rupees per day. Now, at the end of the day, we are going to call a Brahmin to perform the puja, and he will be paid a few thousand rupees, right? And he should be provided the best of grains that you have, or rice, or the best of fruits and vegetables that you have, and you should not bargain with him the wages. So now, how are we paying so much for labor where there is no output, where there is no productivity, right? So similarly, now I'm going to an university, I'm teaching there, I'm being paid about close to 3000 rupees per day or little more than that, whereas a gardener or a housekeeping staff in my own department or my own university is paid 235 rupees per day. What is this logic actually? Why is physical labor inferior to what I'm doing? At least my intensive labor is for 2 hours, the time that I spend in classroom and teaching. But the rest of the time is not that strenuous, maybe, right? Whereas the physical labor, the housekeeping staff, or the gardeners, or the other horticulture staff, they are working in a strenuous way, and at the end of the day, they are paid some 250 rupees or 235 rupees. So this is how the notion of caste has crept into the modern system in determining the wages in the modern system also. Right? Now, how are we exploited? Why? How are we part of this exploitative design? Is that, see, I'm hiring a servant maid. The servant maid comes and she helps us in every other household to perform every other household course. Then when I go out, I'm earning 3000 rupees per day. I'm earning, if I go out for a lecture, I am for an institute, I'm being paid some 1000 rupees or 1500 rupees. Whereas I am paying 3000 rupees or 5000 rupees for my housemaid. So this is how we are part of this exploitative system, right? Whereas we are getting our regular increments, our regular DA increments, our annual increments, and everything is part of the policy. We are getting it. The formal sector gets that. Whereas when it comes to the laboring masses, there is no such policy. So what is happening here is that their insecurity, their next food is insecure. And because their next meal is insecure, they have to subject themselves to this job. So whatever maybe you are giving them or you are paying them, say for example, 100 rupees or 120 rupees that you pay per day or 150 rupees you pay per day for a housemaid, right? That is because of the hunger that she is, the threatening hunger that she might have to face if she is not earning that too, right? So this is the point here. So the basic point is that as a person, I have my foresight. I know that every 30 days I'm going to get my salary, right? I know how to manage my funds. And given this, right, I can borrow a loan. I can get a loan from bank, and I can buy an asset now. I may not have money now, but I can borrow a loan. I can buy an asset now, and I can repay this in terms of EMIs. Right? But then such a luxury is not there for someone who doesn't have a permanent job or a salary certificate, salary slip, right? So now, and you should also understand the politics of banking. We have a banking sector, you know, when the 93% of the economy is informal, we have a banking sector which doesn't cater to them at all, right? If you don't have a permanent job, or if you don't have a pay slip, or if you don't have some assets in terms of gold or house or land, you have no business with banks, right? So the banks are completely inaccessible, right? So now it is this collective insecurity that is imposed upon the laboring classes that prolongs our luxuries. Our luxuries today are exploitation of their hunger. So their food is insecure, their children's education is insecure, their next meal is insecure, and because of that, they are subjecting themselves to this exploitation design. And now we are at the benefiting end of it. So with this, I think I just have to say that all that luxuries that we have today are nothing but something that is built upon the exploited labor of the poor, and for which they were given only food and not anything more. So the minimum wages is something, nothing more than food, right? Your economics teachers may say that food, shelter, and clothing are basic essentials, but they will never tell you why the hell that minimum wages is one square meal a day. So with this, I conclude my presentation, and I look forward for discussions and interactions more. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for listening.
Jerome,
yes.
The way you have carried out your presentation, starting from the structure of caste and the social stratification, which is graded inequality, as Baba Saheb Ambedkar has described it, and how that continues even today in terms of the policy making and keeping the people just merely on the level of survival, and how this the same social order continues to haunt the millions, as you pointed out in your presentation. So it's nothing but the continuation of the caste system, though in the name of modern politics or political policies or economic policies, what is happening is they are just like a top dressing. Nothing has really changed. The structure remains the same. A few escape because of the affirmative action and because of the reservation and people's efforts, but largely it appears that it remains the same, right?
Yes.
So there are a few questions, and we will go to them. One of the question is, what were the prevailing discourses in the discipline of economy during the time of Ambedkar? And what paradigm shift Ambedkar brought in the discourse of economy as well as in the discipline of economy?
One problem that I see with the discipline of economics is that it doesn't understand anything other than money or something like in terms of money, right? It doesn't understand humiliation. It doesn't understand, it doesn't internalize hunger and suffering as part of their curriculum. So they have their own statistics with which they talk about poverty and they talk about hunger. And now one advantage that Baba Saheb had is that he could understand caste structure and the exploitative threats of class structure in its entirety. And it is this perspective that helps him to propose certain policies. Now, when he talks about labor rights, or when he talks about minimum wages, or 8-hour labor day, and so on, all these have come because of that. And what I see is that the entire mainstream economics continues to be much more insensitive, or has become even more insensitive than it what it was before. And so the struggle that he might have put in to say that these are all things that should be part of policy making and so on. So this is something where there needs to be a deviation from the mainstream. But unfortunately, what I see in Indian academia is that Indian academia never treats caste as economic. They always try to sideline caste as social, right, or cultural, or whatever it may be, right? But they never recognize caste as economic, right? And by doing so, they have retained the curriculum very insensitive, and the people from the oppressed societies, oppressed communities, they will never understand that why their struggles or why their everyday sufferings are not part of their curriculum, or why so the point is that the moment you enter the economics classroom, right, it gives an impression that you should forget all the social sufferings and all the deprivation and subordination, right? And once you learn micro, macro, and so on, and everything is determined by demand and supply and so on, right? So you don't have any space to think of your own plight and try to interpret that in terms of economics. What kind of economics should we be studying, or how we should interpret economics in our own everyday life? So the point is, the insensitivity is retained. So long as you don't talk about caste, right? So the economics mainstream retains its insensitivity, and the struggles of the oppressed will never be part of it.
Jerome, that reminds me of Babasaheb Ambedkar. And as you know, we know that in the Columbia University and also London School of Economics, he studied economy, and he studied political economy. He studied monetary economy. If you look at the problem of rupees, he studied public finances and so on and so forth. And also we know that he was I think one of the most studied person in labor economics in the country. That is, he studied whatever he lay his hands onto. So during his stint as a labor minister in the Viceroy's Council, he says that the government has been concentrating only on two things: taxation and law and order. But since he joined the office, he was focusing on housing, he was focusing on education, he was focusing on business, and his politics, as you say, his economy, as you say, it was not based on the money or demand and supply. It was based completely on what we can say the common man's welfare. In other words, welfare economics.
Yes.
Isn't it? As a development economist, you can throw some light on it. The welfare economies, how that goes with the so-called macro, micro you have been talking about.
So the point is, this idea of constructing houses for Dalits, right? It comes from the colonial period, where my PhD thesis is about the Panchama land, the assignments to Dalits made in 1890s. Okay, so basically, if you see the colonial revenue administration, they call for reports from district collectors, and there are two occasions where the district collectors had to report about the depressed classes to the House of Commons and so on. So first was in 1812 when the governor asked for a report on slavery in the Madras presidency or in all the presidencies, right? So they all the district collectors had to create a report about slavery and submit it, and in which the interpreters, the dubashes for all the white officers were the upper caste, and they said that there is nothing called a slavery here. All of them are working as laborer willingly. So they are willing to subordinate themselves and they are working work as slaves, right? So this was the report, and but somehow they managed to abolish slavery because of consistent effort by the missionaries and so on. In 1890s, once again, when the colonial government tried to assign land to the Dalits, they suggested three policies for their amelioration. First was that construction of schools for the Panchamas. Second is construction of household for the Panchamas. And the third is assignment of cultivable wasteland to the Panchamas. Right? Why is this construction of houses came? Because whenever they tried to approach the colonial government, whenever the oppressed caste tried to directly get in touch with the colonial government, the dominant caste of the village, they went and threatened them, they beat them, they burned their houses, they beat them, the violence, so much violence was there. So the collector of Chengalpet understood that the systematic violence by the dominant caste and said, since these people are living in the huts erected in the zamindars, the landlord's land, so they should be given houses in government-owned land and they should be made owners of that. So then the idea of constructing colonies comes in, right? So the point here is, say, for example, let me also put it bluntly, that most of the welfare measures in the recent days after the independence, right, have not come from economists. Most of the measures have come only from well-meaning politicians, be it noon meal schemes, right? Take the case of noon meal schemes in school. It came because of Kamarajar, right? We have constructed school, the children are not coming, right? They said that the children will come to school when they are given food. So food becomes part of education. Provision of food becomes part of education. Similarly, the PD system, the public disposal system, right? That is something which relieved the laborers from the clutches of the dominant caste. See, if you live in a society where you have to depend on the dominant caste for your every meal, every dinner, or every food, right? You are completely subordinated and you will never have any minimal guts to, or any minimal disobedience will be there, right? Now this public disposal system is something which enabled, provided food for the people, and that creates the possibility of mobility, right? So in a society like this, we have to create our economics of ourselves, right? We cannot work on the disciplinary boundaries that the Western societies have. We have to create our economics. We have to write our economics, our own economics, taking into consideration the plight of the people living in our society. And if you have to empower the people who are oppressed, who are stagnated in a particular job for generations after generations, right? If we have to empower them, if we have to empower their mobility, we cannot create policies based on Western dictates. We cannot create policies based on IMF and World Bank's dictates. We have to create policies looking at the ground reality and then so this is something where the Baba Saheb's contribution is there. And in fact, I should also say that in Tamil Nadu, Kamarajar and Karunanidhi have contributed in this regard, because they are the one, they are the pioneers of bringing in this noon meal scheme and also the BDS system, right? PDS system. And when 25 kgs of rice is given to every household in the rural, free of cost, right? They need not worry about the hunger. They did not have fear about the family's hunger. They can go to a nearest urban area. They can go in search of job. Even if they don't get job in a day or two, they don't have to worry. They don't have to fear, because their family won't sleep in hunger. So this is something. The basic point is that the entire exploration of Indian society is the politics of hunger. So unless we kind of intrude into that politics and provide food for the people, ensure food for the people, we cannot empower their socioeconomic mobility.
So Jerome, what we see today, what is happening this post-COVID is not post-COVID, we are still in the COVID times. And a lot of poor migrants have been walking thousands of distances, and there is so much suffering which is going on. People have termed it as a walking class, which is basically not a walking class, but it's basically Dalits and Adivasis and a host of the marginalized communities and the caste. Are you still there, Jerome? Jerome, you there? Hello, Jerome, you back? Can you hear me?
I'm here, yeah.
Okay. So what I'm saying, looking at the current situation in our country today, where thousands of people are walking on their feet, going back to their villages, for walking long distances, That's the scenario on the street. That is the fact of, you know, so many millions of lives today in our country today. At the same time, we are seeing that the labor laws are being tweaked and they are stacked very heavily against the laborers. As we know that particularly if we speak politically here, the state ruled by BJP, they have completely done away with the labor laws. So how do we see that, you know, on one hand, there is a set of policies which is pushing the laborers again into the vicious cycle of poverty and exploitation. And as you said, malnutrition, hunger. And on the other hand, the people are already on the street. So as an economist, how do you see, won't it hit twice to the laborers? What is happening in terms of the labor policies today?
The point is that, we never had a policy to value someone's labor, value someone's productivity based on the kind of effort that they have put, right? If someone is putting 8 hours of work, right, and in a particular locality, that 8 hours of work, you know, in order to facilitate that, they have to survive in that particular locality. They need a place of stay. They need a comfortable house, or they need some basic essentials in their house. They need basic electricity and all that. So if someone has to have all that and then be available for work, then the value of their labor is something that should be more. But what we have here is that we are having a habit of not putting them to deprivation and then saying that you have nothing with you, right? At least you will get this 100 rupees if you come and work for me, right? So that is a plight. See, imagine after 7 decades of policy making, right? If the MGNREG is saying that we are paying 200 rupees pay wages per day per family for 100 days, we just mean that they have no other source for that 100 rupees or 200 rupees, right? So what does this policy making contribute to them? The laboring masses have nothing. If the government has to create a scheme and then go to the rural houses and then give them 200 rupees per day for 100 days in a year, right? So what is the kind of policy making that we had? What kind of economic impact that has it created? Now, this 100 rupees or 200 rupees that we are paying as part of MGNREGA, that has been stopped now. After the present government came in, so that MGNREGA has been stopped. And now, post-COVID, they are saying that they are kind of restarting it. But then the point is, you are paying 200 rupees per day for 100 days. So how will they survive the rest 265 days in a year? So that is something that, so the thing is that what is not done is never being spoke, right? So the silence, right? So say, for example, someone, the meme.
Can we call it a conspiracy of silence, Jerome?
Yeah, it's a conspiracy of silence, yeah. So the point is, one square meal a day is the poverty line, right? As if we don't eat 3 times a day, right? So what is the silence? You know, we are completely sidelining 2 other meals which the family has to eat, right? So this is the politics. This is the politics. This is the injustice, or this is dishonesty that the academia and the researchers have done to the poor. Now coming back, in the name of neoliberal policies, right? The World Bank and IMF and all the developed countries have been imposing policies to cut down our subsidies. Our gas subsidies are cut down. Our ration shop, our PDA system is cut down, right? Then the electricity for agriculture is cut down, right? So all the subsidies are being cut down. The educational subsidies are cut down. They are asking the school, government to stop the noon meal scheme in the school. They are asking the government to stop, reduce the expenditure on noon meal scheme. So right. they are asking the governments to cut down all the subsidies that has been given for the people. But the problem here is, now the moment this COVID started, all the developed countries have given a relief package for the entire population. They gave $1,500 per day, per week, right? So given that, right, they have given packages for their industries, right? So, and the problem is, one very, very strong objection that I have with this neoliberal development paradigm is that, see, the moment this pandemic broke out, right, there were people stranded without house. Los Angeles airport was opened to house the homeless, right? Then there were people standing in queues to collect their everyday meal, right? The same is the situation in the UK, in England, right? how can this be development model for us? When there are so much people homeless, when there are so much people who are unable to survive a single day, right? How can that country or that policies be the policy for ourselves? Right? We have to seriously rethink that. And I see that, I see and I wish that this pandemic becomes an end of an era, end of these neoliberal policies, neoliberal capitalist policies. This should be the end of it. And what I see is that I see literally there's an end of it also, because there are 95% of the population are on the roads. They don't have food, right? They don't have food. They're on the streets, right? All the informal sector is outside. The only people who want the state now are the salaried class, like me, right? I'm employed. I'm given a permanent employment. I want when the government is not taking care of the hunger of the people, the government is not taking care of the transport of the people, they are allowing the people to walk thousands of kilometers, hundreds of kilometers without food and water, right? What we now see here is that I, being an employee of a state, right? I have my permanent job. I have borrowed loans from bank. I have borrowed some properties. And I want my job to continue just because I want to retain my property that I have been bought on loan, right? So only the employees of the state want the state to continue. And the state doesn't exist for the rest of the population.
Now that's very bold of you to say like that, Jerome. You know, you are, as I know you, you have been always forthright and always very audacious to talk about the facts and the realities around you. And that brings us, you know, that answers one of the questions that was raised by the audience here. Like, can you point out how COVID-19 is going to affect the socioeconomic life of Dalits and Adivasis in line with central finance minister's economic package? So I think that answers more or less the question.
Yeah, the point is that, see, when it comes to this monetary policies and so on, where is this channel actually? There is no channel at all. Say, for example, no, people say that I used to ask, there are my colleagues who are monetary economists with me. I used to ask them, no, when there is inflation, how does RBI take care of it? They said that no, they will cut down inflation, but how do they do it? We are facing a series of price hike, continuous price hike due to petrol prices, right? The increase in petrol prices leads to food commodities and all other services hike, right? So when I ask that, they say that RBI will do it through banks. So see, what they don't realize is that 93% of the economy is informal, right? And if at all the RBI has to do something, it has to do through the banks, right? And we have a population, not more than 30% have bank account. And how we brought it to 30% is that, 30-35% is that, we forced all those beneficiaries of MGNREGA to open bank account, whose bank account remains dormant, but for this transaction by the MGNREGA scheme, right? Their entire bank account is useless. Right? Their bank account is active only when there is a transfer from the government. Right? And for others, if you don't have a permanent job, if you don't have assets, you have nothing to do with the banks. So how can the banking channel be effective monetary policy for the execution of monetary policy? It cannot be. And one other problem is that when the market is informal, right? When the vegetable market, when the food grains market, when the entire market is informal, right? Where is the channel for RBI to make its role here? There's no channel at all, right?
That's so, very deep insight, Jerome. That's a very deep insight. It reminds me of one of the papers that has been written on the economics of caste, wherein it is said that as we go on the so-called social hierarchy in India, the social capital increases. For example, if you follow this pyramid of the caste, and the more lower we go, the social capital decreases because the caste system completely demolishes the social trust between the people. And it leaves the masses into disorganized mass, like as Babasaheb Ambedkar says, that the millions are reduced to fractions because of the caste system. And what you are saying is, the disorganization increases as we go down, and as we go up, the people are more solidly networked. They have a social capital, and we know that, as you have shown in your presentation, that this social pyramid completely matches with the administration, with judiciary,
yes,
with the universities, and all. It's just replicated, it's just transformed into into the ancient pyramid, into the modern political system, modern judiciary, or you know, like that. So I think what you have been suggesting, what kind of an approach you would suggest, you know, like you are also working in the movement, in the Dalit movement for a long time, and you have also taken up the issue of the Dalit land rights, you know, the kind of the land policies and what the access to land. So how do you see, as an economist and a person who is working in the movement, what kind of the strategies that we can work out to really take this, you know, demolish this old model of doing the things and, you know, bring a new one?
The point is, see, what I say is that it's already an end of an era. I certainly want this to be an end of an era, but then I don't know whether that will be materializing. So because, see, there is no use to be at the bottom of the supply chain of the Western world, right? So we are, see, you take the case of special economic zones, okay? We rob off the land of the locals, we give it to the corporates, we give them tax holidays for 10 years, right? And we give them electricity subsidized for 10 years, we don't charge for water, right? And after all that, they produce their cars, they produce their products in our own land, and sell it at world prices. Okay. If at all I have to purchase the car at world prices, I can import it. Why should I allow all this exploiting the local resources for their benefit?
Right.
There is no need. So now, so it is high time that the economists start thinking about this. Why should we continue to be part of this bottom of the supply chain? So the point is, we should realize that how are these economic systems facilitating the exploitation of the bottom? The luxuries that we have today are certainly the exploited money of the bottom. It is not that our profit, every bit of profit is exploited hunger of the bottom, right? Yeah. So it is certainly that. So we have to come to terms with that. And I know the point is that, to be ethical, we should have the guts to forego our comforts today,
right?
Which we don't have. We are cowards. We don't want to forego our comforts today. So we sustain that. We give the people at the bottom a false hope that things will change in due course in a matter of 10 years or 20 years or 30 years. But then we don't reveal that there are plantation workers who are plantation workers for 4 or 5 generations. There are manual scavengers who are manual scavengers for 4 or 5 generations. There are barbers who are barbers for 4 or 5 generations, right? So likewise, the stagnation is stagnated. No, the people who are stagnated, right, they remain stagnated. So where is the hope for them in this system? So I feel that this system needs to be dismantled. This, you know, we have to create a system where mutual human respect and dignity is part of that system. Unless we create such system, we cannot ensure a kind of egalitarian society. And I see that the entire developing countries of the world should rethink. Should they continue to be part of this supply chain, bottom of the supply chain?
Right. That's what wonderfully said, Jerome. I think as we come to our end of the session today, I would just like to say that unless we develop these grassroots social movements and strengthen the people's network on the ground and really enable them or empower them to demand their rightful their rights as mentioned in our constitution, their rights. And one of the things that was missing in our Indian constitution was that Baba Saheb Ambedkar wanted to make economic rights as the fundamental rights, but it couldn't happen. And he has written this wonderful alternative constitution, the state and minorities, where he's sort of giving a plan of action for you know, changing the society from bottom up, right?
Yeah.
So I think we got all those frameworks in place. As you said, that we need to mobilize our people. We need to sacrifice. We have to be brave. We have to be audacious. And at the same time, we should keep on learning the failures of the system, pointing them out to the common masses, and communicate like you do in their everyday language. Yeah. So we feel that what you are doing is very, very important work, and to bring these complex ideas like labor economics, the wages, the minimum wages to the people, and make them understand how these policies, they are not innocent policies. They have a very deeper and very far-reaching impact on the people.
Yeah.
So they are not just policies for them. They are like do or die situation. Their life is at stake, if we can use the word stake. And I think it was a wonderful session today, Jerome. And I would like to thank you on behalf of the Ambedkar Caravan Media for having given your time, really very invaluable time, and providing the insights into the economies of caste. And it's so obvious that unless we fight this monster of caste, we cannot really have the economic transformation in this country. That's very clear from your presentation. Please go. Yeah. So I'm going to hand over for the concluding remarks.
Only one point I wish to make. See, for example, India is a very unequal society, and our schooling is unequal, our education system is unequal, our college education is unequal, and we as individual employees of the state, of the government, we are responsible to uphold the idea of equality and justice, social justice. But the problem is, the system has no mechanism for that, right? Say, for example, take an education institution. Education institution is hiring people from all across the caste ladder, all across the religious spectrum, right?
Right.
So now, how does the system ensure that every teacher treats every student equally? There is no such mechanism for that. It is left to the ethics of individual teacher.
True.
And even when there are complaints, we have shameless teachers who protect their fellow teachers from any action against them, right? So the point is that we should own up the responsibility of upholding equality wherever they are. And even if it amounts to talking against the power in your own institution or in your own immediate boss or whatever it may be, you should have the guts to do that. Unless you do that, we can have policies. Like Baba Saheb Ambedkar says that, after everything, after the constitution, everything he writes, Buddhanism, and says that we cannot enact laws to make people love each other. Right? Yeah. So I can have policies. Government can create policies. It is up to individuals who are taking up employment in the government to stand by that. So the point is, the individual ethics should be there, and there is no mechanism intact in the system to uphold that individual ethics. So this is something that, because I'm a teacher, I see how diverse my classroom. It is not diverse, how unequal my classroom is. So it is the teacher's responsibility to make the classroom an egalitarian space. In terms of language, in terms of participation, in terms of examination, everything should be equal. So such atmosphere is we are yet to create, and because we don't create that sensitivity. Caste is not part of the curriculum. Untouchability is not part of the curriculum. We may have Gandhi's verses in the textbook covers, but then if you ask, untouchability is a sin, untouchability is a crime, and so on. But what is untouchability? Right? I may be reading untouchability is a crime and all these things in the textbook. And in my own house, I may give a separate tumbler and a separate plate to my servant maid.
Yeah.
I may give separate tumbler and plate to my own colleague in my or a housekeeping staff in my department. So caste is everywhere. The point is we need to create a sensitization where we have to make people aware that unless we decasteize ourselves, we are casteist.
True.
Yeah. Thank you.
That's a very final concluding statement, Jerome Bhai. And we know that you will continue to strive for the struggle that you are always been part of all your life. Mm-hmm. And we are very happy to have you here. Thank you on the behalf of Ambedkar Caravan and those listeners who have been listening today. We are very sorry for the brief interruption because of the voice, but I think we have solved it, And because it was such a important information that I had to interrupt you, that everybody wanted to listen to you.
Yeah, sorry. I was thinking this Bluetooth is new and this should be better than the mic, which is part of this laptop.
Right. So anyway, I think we have just begin to touch on the economies of caste, and we will bring to you more and more presentations on the economic structure, what we can do, even the comparative analysis of the different paradigms in the economics, even what is Ambedkar economics, because he was an economist. So we need to bring out the threads from his writings and speeches, view them together into a practicing theory which we can apply. But all said and done, as Jerome said, that we need to mobilize our people, we need to come together, we need to really stand together, and we really need to go ahead together. So as you know, that we are bringing to you a lot of this presentation, and we'll continue to do that. You can look at our websites from time to time, particularly the Facebook page from time to time, and note those important events in your calendar, because a lot of people make efforts to find their time and their talent to make presentations before you. And we hope that we will be able to bring such enlightening lectures, such enlightening presentations and talk to you always. With this, I conclude. Jai Bhim. And
thank you,
see you soon.
Thank you, Jai Bhim.